going to list for you the four most important things you need to be teaching your new puppy. And spoiler alert, it doesn't include obedience commands. Keep watching. What's up, guys? It's Jenna with Dog Liaison, where I coach you on how to enhance your dog's mental health. And on this channel, we break down scientific research in order to inform and educate us on how to train dogs. If you are watching this video, you have a brand new puppy. First of all, congratulations. Second of all, I'm sure you're feeling overwhelmed. I'm sure that when you have this new dog, you feel like you are being inundated with so much information, and you feel like there's so much you're supposed to be teaching your puppy right now that it's hard to prioritize. On one hand, you're getting nipped at because they're puppy teething and they're chewing on your hands, and on the other hand, they're crying in the crate, and on the other hand, you're supposed to be teaching them sit, down, and come, and all this junk, and it can be overwhelming to feel like you have so much work to do. But that's why this video is about prioritizing the top four things you need to do. And we're getting started right now. The first lesson you need to teach your puppy is to teach your dog independence. That wasn't the first lesson you were expecting, huh? You're probably expecting you're supposed to teach the dog sit. And spoiler alert, that's not the first lesson. One of the most important parts about training a puppy is understanding that you are equipping your dog with life skills. So the way I explain it is sort of like when kids go to school. When you have a kid who is in math class and they're learning the quadratic formula, they're actually learning problem-solving skills. When you have a kid who is reading Shakespeare, they're actually learning to read critically. When you have a dog, when you have a kid writing an essay, it's actually about making sure they can form an argument. And that's how you want to think about raising your puppy. You're not giving your dog a bunch of list of obedience commands that they're supposed to perform into perpetuity. What you're actually doing is equipping your dog with the life skills that he needs in order to live a happy, content life on earth. And starting with teaching your dog independence. Now, sometimes teaching your dog independence can mean crate training or station training, that is like you're putting them in a pen, or you're just teaching your dog to stay outside by himself. But really what it comes down to is a couple of things. One, you're teaching your dog how to entertain himself when he's alone. You're teaching him that he can play with his ball by himself, he can chew on a toy by himself. He does not need to be reliant on another person or another dog to keep him entertained. Now, absolutely some personalities are going to want that more. More extroverted personalities are going to crave the energy of others around them. They're going to feel more fulfilled if they are near another person or another dog. That's true. And to a certain extent, that's a little bit genetic and you can't really affect that. But you absolutely can make sure that the dog from an early stage, from an early age, is able to be independent and is able to entertain himself. The other thing you're doing when you decide to leave your dog is you're making sure that he does not have separation anxiety. And so this really comes down to making sure you do in fact leave your dog alone. Part of keeping building independence is making sure that you actually do leave your puppy. I know that we want to stay home all day, every day with our puppy to make sure that they are being well behaved and everything. But really that sets the dogs up for false expectations. Really that just makes the dogs believe that for the rest of their life, mom and dad is always gonna be home. So you do want to slowly implement time away. You're not doing 8-hour shifts away right out of the get-go, but you definitely don't want the dog to think that you're going to be home with him 24/7. And so putting him in his crate or putting him in his pen and leaving for dinner or going to the grocery store is going to be really important. So you actually want to think of your first lesson as, I need to give my dog independence. What are some ways I can do that? What are some ways that I can get him playing by himself, entertaining himself, sleeping by himself, being okay alone when it's necessary? The second life skill that you want to equip your dog with is the ability to ask questions. That's right, you want your dog asking questions. You want your dog saying, what is that? What if I do it this way? What if I do it that way? What if I do it over there? You want your dog asking those questions because actually, in my opinion, the smartest dogs do ask the most questions. There's a huge difference between intelligence and trainability. Trainability is the dog does everything you ask. Intelligence, in my opinion, is the dog asks a lot of questions. The dog says, okay, you just taught me how to do sit in this corner. Is sit still exist in that corner? What if I do sit outside? What if I do sit on my hip instead of on my hocks? So a dog that is asking and experimenting with a lot of different ways of performing the exact same skill or the exact same cue is actually really impressive because it requires a lot of critical thinking skills. I know that a lot of times we view a dog who is not responding as being stubborn, but sometimes the dog is literally just asking for clarification. And if you don't know what I mean, I recommend you check out this video because that video is all about when you need to actually repeat a cue or when you need to give more explanation. Now, the way you get a dog to ask questions is through using shaping methods. And this would be the opposite of using luring methods. Perhaps you have heard that you are supposed to put the treat up to the dog's nose and lure them back. I really don't encourage that because it doesn't give the dog the opportunity to volunteer behaviors. It doesn't give the dog the opportunity to try things and experiment and ask questions. And so I would recommend checking out this video if you don't know what I'm talking about, but that video was really about making sure that you're not using a lure, but you are using a shaping or capturing method. Those methods, capturing and shaping, are going to elicit a lot more creativity and a lot more questions from your dog than really any other training strategy. The third life skill that I think is really important is that you're teaching your dog how to be calm. Now, a lot of times when our puppy finally goes and lays down in the corner and is finally silent, finally isn't getting into something, we have this way of just stopping and saying, nobody move, nobody freeze, nobody call the dog, because if you move, the dog will wake up or the dog will go do whatever. And a lot of times these calm moments that the puppies offer go unrecognized. And remember that you want to be treating desired behaviors and ignoring undesired behaviors. So when you see your puppy is finally doing the thing you want, you need to make sure you're rewarding that thing. If you see your puppy laying in the corner being a good dog, you gotta tell her that she's being a good dog. And you do that by very calmly taking a treat over to her and dropping it right in front of her nose. You're putting it on the ground next to her. You're not saying anything. You don't even have to use a marker if you don't want to. You very calmly, you don't have to touch her. You don't have to make it a big event. You're just casually capturing her decision to be over there by herself, chewing on whatever, right? And the more you decide to reward these calm behaviors, the more frequent they'll happen. You can increase the probability that they will happen. So take the time to notice when your dog is doing a desired calm behavior. Now, the next lesson that I think is really crucial for dogs to learn is to teach the dog about the world. Take the dog out of the house. I know that we have a lot of misinformation telling us that you cannot take a dog out until they have the rabies vaccine. I recommend you check out this video if you don't know what I'm talking about, but it has been proven and stated over and over and over again that the risk of not taking a puppy outside of the house to learn about the world is much greater than the risk of that puppy getting a disease, particularly if they've already had their first or second round of vaccines. So please take your dog, if they're 12 weeks, 13 weeks, 14 weeks old, outside of the house. Please do that. So when you're taking your dog out into the world, you want to make sure that they are smelling. Please let them smell, let them observe, but making sure that you are giving a positive association to those things as well. Emotional outcome is positive. So that might be that you're giving treats, but it also could just be that you're playing with toys, making sure that they are engaging with people in a fun way, and that they are having a lot of pleasant, positive experiences. It's not enough to just let them go out and stare at the world. If they're going out and staring at the world and bad things are happening, then what they're learning is that the world is bad. So the association, the safety matters more than the obedience. You can teach any dog to sit. You can teach any dog down. You can teach any dog to come when called, right? But you have a very short window to be shaping your dog's personality to be the dog that you want them to be. So if you want a little bit more information on that, I also recommend checking out this video. It expands a little bit on the critical learning development, but there's a very brief window in your puppy's lifetime that you can shape her personality to be what you want it to be. And that time limit is brief. That time limit only goes to about 16 weeks. So on the other hand, you can teach any dog at any age, at any years old, to learn how to sit or down. You can't necessarily teach any puppy to socialize and to be more amicable. And something I can tell you about my private sessions with my puppies that I work with is that I don't spend a whole lot of time focusing on the sits and the downs. In my hours with my clients, we are working on a lot more life skills based things, a lot more critical thinking skills. And we save the sort of obedience elements, the come when called, the loose leash walk, the sit, the down, the whatever. We save those for group classes because group classes are really important for young puppies. Group classes give them the opportunity to be out in the world. And I will link something in the description box below, but it has been proven that puppies who are in puppy classes are less likely to demonstrate aggressive behavior or fearful behavior later on life. And so we know that group classes have been proven to help the sociability of a young puppy. And so what I do with my clients is I recommend that they do the group class for some of these basic skills, some of the sits and the downs and the commands, right? And then with me, we work on more of these much more difficult life skills. We much more work on problem solving and independence and things like that that you may not necessarily get from more obedience training. Now, just as overwhelmed as you are with all of the things you have to teach your puppy, I think it's equally important that you learn the things that you do not need to teach your puppy. So in my next video, I will be giving 4 do nots. Do not teach your puppy this. In my next video, make sure you hit subscribe to get notified when that goes live. And if you're watching this well into the future, then that video is linked somewhere right here. And if you enjoyed my content, make sure you hit subscribe and like, and I'll see y'all soon.